Thanks for joining me in the History of Science Collections of the University of Oklahoma Libraries. Let's look at a few treasures from the vault that throw light on theories of the Earth in the Middle Ages and beyond. Beginning with Pierre Duhem, scholars have shown that divine omnipotence required the created order to be contingent, and therefore not completely transparent to rational demonstration. If nature is contingent, that is, if it might have been made otherwise than it is, then Aristotle's physics and cosmology must be revised to allow more than one possible outcome. In the hands of 14th century writers like William Ockham, Jean Buridan, and Nicole Arim, a critique of Aristotelian rational necessity led to such ideas as the possible existence of other worlds, a rotating Earth, and an Earth characterized not by eternity, but by a very ancient history that might be reconstructed on the basis of empirical evidence. Let's focus on the example of an ancient Earth with an interesting history. The history of geology may be summarized as the answer to the question, why are seashells found on mountaintops? If so, then the answer we expect to find in the Middle Ages is that Noah's flood put them there. This is Herbarium Diluvianum by Scheuchzer, published in 1723. Yet it turns out that the deluge of Noah was far from the only explanation for seashells on the mountaintops, even in the Middle Ages. In Wonderful Life, Stephen Jay Gould considers the implications of the fact that life forms in the Precambrian eon are so different from present-day animals that we never would have been able to guess that they had existed had we not discovered them by empirical investigation. In the same way, by rational reconstruction, we would never guess how theories of the Earth actually developed in the Middle Ages and beyond. Scheuchzer himself gives us a clue in another work, the first volume of his Sacred Physics, a commentary in the hexameral tradition, considering the 6 days of creation in Genesis 1. According to the 6 days of creation, mountains were formed long before Noah's flood, probably on the third day when the dry land was separated from the sea. Mountains and all the Earth's life forms even predate humans, according to Genesis 1. Conventions of biblical illustration confirm this impression. According to traditional interpretations of Genesis, one must seek the origin of mountains before the arrival of human beings. Mountains were already present in the creation week and in the Garden of Eden. We find the same convention at work throughout the history of biblical illustration, as in the 1560 first edition of the Geneva Bible. In the Nuremberg Chronicle, the most lavishly illustrated printed work of the 15th century, the Earth is formed with its mountains and water cycle intact on the third day, rather than as a result of Noah's deluge. Medieval writers about the Earth could draw upon Plato's theory of subterranean circulations of water and fire, as in this striking 17th century illustration by Athanasius Kircher. For Plato, these subterranean circulations would lead eventually to catastrophic episodes of crustal collapse, as in the myth of the lost continent of Atlantis. Aristotle's meteorology, on the other hand, emphasized the mechanism of wandering shorelines, the gradual shifting over time of the boundaries between dry land and the seas, as in the silting up of ancient river deltas. Hundreds of medieval commentaries on Aristotle's meteorology continued to adopt such long-term cyclical processes. Stoic cosmology added a third mechanism, the dissolution of the world, whether by water or fire. Writers in the Stoic tradition like Seneca, Cicero, Basil, and Augustine regarded the Earth as changing in a slow cycle in the balance between water and fire, suspended between dissolutions of the world, an idea picked up in this 17th century theory of the Earth of John Woodward. We can see these various traditions combined in a famous diagram from this 17th century work by the anatomist Nicholas Steno. Steno set out to reconstruct the history of the hillsides and mountains around Tuscany. He discerned a three-step cycle, repeated a second time. In the first step, horizontal strata are laid down by gradual deposition. This represents the tradition of Aristotle's meteorology. In the second step, reminiscent of Plato and the Stoics, subterranean circulations dissolve the strata, leading to the third step of crustal collapse. The first cycle occurred with rock that contains no fossils. The cycle was repeated a second time with fossiliferous rocks. After thus invoking the favored mechanisms of Aristotle, Plato, and the Stoics, in a nod to the hexameral tradition, Steno hints in his historical reconstruction that the first episode of crustal collapse occurred on the third day of creation. Still another tradition that provided theoretical resources for reconstructing the history of the Earth was alchemy. This is a copy of the Hermetic Corpus, including an alchemical account of creation, printed in 1584. At that time, the Hermetic writings were regarded as a pristine wisdom that had been passed down from Hermes, who was believed to be none other than Moses. Rather than a base pursuit of riches by means of turning metals into gold, alchemy was a spiritual pursuit to simulate in the laboratory the same methods by which God had created the earth. The alchemist is the ape of nature, sought to explain the origin of the earth as the result of chemical processes of separation and distillation. This is the major work of Roger Bacon, a medieval writer and alchemist, not to be confused with Francis Bacon, who lived several centuries later. According to Roger Bacon, the earth responded to the influence of the sun upon dry land in much the same way as bread rises when baked in the oven. The heat of the sun creates caverns beneath the surface of the earth, just as the baking of bread makes the top rise. So to begin the process of the formation of the earth, all one needs is an initial exposure of the dry land to sunlight, or perhaps even to the stars. Then the earth expands like baking bread in that direction. From that point on, the process is automatic. This illustration of that initial separation of the dry land from the sea is from Buffon's Natural History of 1749. Once the dry land begins to rise, the inhabited hemisphere of the earth bobs like a cork upon the waters of the Western Hemisphere. Historian Marshall Claggett's study of Archimedes in the Middle Ages fills many volumes. With a mathematical focus on centers of gravity, medieval natural philosophers distinguished between the center of the Earth's gravity and the center of the Earth's magnitude. The center of the Earth's magnitude or volume rose above the center of gravity as the dry land rose due to baking in the sun. Occasionally, earthquakes would occur as the land adjusts its balance. In the 14th century, Jean Buridan and Nicole Arem took these ideas several steps further. Their answer to the question why seashells appear on the mountaintops envisioned a three-step process of erosion, deposition, and elevation. First, as the dry land rises in the baking of the sun, it erodes. Streams carry sediment that is deposited, forming new layers of strata on the bottom of the ocean in the watery hemisphere. These layers may contain embedded fossils of seashells, but eventually these layers shift upward as the rising land of the dry hemisphere continues to adjust its center of magnitude upward in small earthquakes. If the process goes on long enough, then the layers originally formed on the ocean beds will rise past the center of the earth and emerge on the top of the opposite side, forming new mountains that are then eroded to start the cycle once again. These new mountains contain seashells because the strata were formed on the bed of the ocean. Buridan and Arem each developed this idea in distinctive ways and concluded that because The process has gone on long enough for seashells to occur in our current mountains, then the Earth must be very, very old. Buridan published his theory in a commentary on Aristotle's Meteorology. A rem included it in a popular book he wrote for the King of France. In the De Revolutionibus, Copernicus in 1543 paused in this great work of astronomy to consider the recent discovery of the New World in the Western Hemisphere. Copernicus proved that the center of the land and the center of the water coincide. The intellectual heirs of Buridan and Rem therefore concluded that the cycles of erosion, deposition, and elevation must operate on a regional scale instead of a global scale. And these views were known to Steno. Many scientific textbooks regard James Hutton as the founder of geology because his cycles of deposition, erosion, and elevation were envisioned as ensuring a perpetually habitable globe. But perhaps his ideas would have seemed somewhat familiar to Buridan, Arim, Copernicus, and Steno. Finally, in this context, let's mention a minor work by Dante. Perhaps we should not be surprised that Dante wrote a disputation on the shape of the Earth, in which he argued that the Earth had been scooped out on one side by an initial event and piled up into a tall mountain on the other, just as described in his Divine Comedy. This formal disputation was based on then-current scientific thinking about the Earth, and Dante wrote it as an argument, not as poetry. Perhaps it's also not so surprising that as a young man, Galileo joined the literary debates of his day over the proportions of Dante's hell, displaying his prowess with calculations of volume based on the mathematics of Archimedes. Science is a story. What stories do you want to hear and tell about medieval science and theories of the Earth?